On behalf of your mother and sisters, I pledge that we, your blood family, will do all we can to continue the imaginative and loving way in which you are steering these two exceptional young men, so that their souls are not simply immersed by duty and tradition, but can sing openly as you planned. We fully respect the heritage into which they have both been born, and will always respect and encourage them in their royal role. But we, like you, recognize the need for them to experience as many different aspects of life as possible, to arm them spiritually and emotionally for the years ahead. I know you would have expected nothing less from us.
Charles, that brilliant speech and that reference to blood family and respecting royalty but other things to do, obviously carefully noted. Did you get criticism for that?
Well, I believe I did. But I mean, I took a view with that speech that if I was going to make it, it had to be honest and it had to be straight. And I stand by every word I said, Larry. I mean, I wrote it in an hour and a half on the Wednesday morning between Diana's death and the actual funeral. And it came from the heart. And I mean, I'm not going to excuse myself. I'm not going to apologize. I stand by it.
Was your family happy with it?
Yeah, very. In fact, extremely so, and very complimentary and sweet about it. I hadn't read it to them beforehand, but they were and still are very happy about it.
Did Charles say anything to you?
Not about the speech, no. But he was, you know, he was perfectly polite all day. We all caught the train from London together to go to the burial in my family home. And nothing nasty has ever been said about it by him to me.
As you look back at the tragedy, do you have any complaints about the way either the hospital authorities or the Paris police dealt with it?
Well, to be honest, I would wait to see how the whole inquest pans out before judging anyone on that issue, including the driver and the photographers. I mean, the fact is there's so much that still has to be resolved. And it's not for me to criticize until the French legal authorities, who I'm sure are very capable, have come up with their findings.
Are you concerned that Dodi Fayed's father thinks it was not an accident?
Well, I'm not concerned that he thinks that, and he's entitled to that view, and I think somebody who's lost their son in such a way will look for such reasons. All I can say is from my point of view, as a brother of the other person who was killed in the passenger seats, I have no evidence at all. I have seen no evidence that it was anything other than the condition maybe of the driver and the pursuit through a tunnel. But I'm not a conspiracy theorist on this at all.
What happened to all her belongings? I know it was auctioned off and a lot went to charity.
That was before she died. A lot of her dresses went to auction.
Yeah, I know that, but I mean after.
They're all in my house, most of them in my house in England.
Are they there now?
Yes.
Are they going to be part of any memorial to her, or?
Well, we have a memorial in the grounds of the house. The house has to be open for 60 days a year, and so it seems fitting to actually celebrate her life in a positive way. And so we have turned over one of the main buildings in the grounds to show her six parts of her life, really, her childhood, her wedding, her charity work, the funeral, and then the biggest room is a sort of celebration of her life with a lot of her dresses, but not just as a fashion show. These are dresses that are in context. We have even her landmine outfit, which she made so famous in her last crusade, mm-hmm. really. All of that, all in context, all explained. And then the last room is perhaps the most moving of all, which is just bank after bank of condolence book behind glass cases, and I think we got over 30,000 there from around the world.
Did you realize how much she was cared about worldwide?
And not only did I not, but I'm pretty sure she didn't as well. I mean, it's an extraordinary thing that we're talking about someone who is very unsure of her position, really, in the world's affections, largely because large elements of the British press were very negative about her the whole time, constantly criticizing her, and it used to make her very, very sad, as I said in the speech. But I don't think she had any idea that she was of such global significance. I mean, she must have noticed how whenever she went anywhere, she lit up a room or an arena or whatever. But to know she had that phenomenal popularity, which we all saw the September before last, I don't think she could have had any idea of that.
We'll take a break, and when we come back, we'll talk about how the kids are doing and about the press, and we'll take your calls. The book is Althorp, The Story of an English House. The author is Charles Spencer. He's our guest. Don't go away.